Rae Armantrout, it's a pleasure to talk with you.
Well, thank you for coming.
Now, you're identified as one of the language poets. Can you explain to us how you see that?
Well, we were a group of poets in New York and San Francisco who came of age really during the Vietnam War and as the Vietnam War was dragging on and on. And I think, though they didn't call it this at the time, we were becoming very aware of what we now call the spin of how the war was presented to us in language. And we got sensitized to that. And we wanted to draw attention to the spin and not look at language as a neutral vehicle for portraying reality, but as something that actually manipulates reality and creates reality. And so part of what we were doing is taking a kind of critical look at that. Another part of language poetry is that in language, most language poets write in sections, whether those sections are sentences or stanzas or other ways to divide a poem, but in sections that are kind of autonomous, that have a sort of semi-autonomy, so that the relationship between the parts is subtle and is perhaps can be seen in different ways depending on the way the reader engages with it.
And so your latest book, Money Shot, really examines, or was a response to, the financial crisis within a number of the poems. Can you explain how that happened?
I think what I do artistically is just not compartmentalize. And in a way, I think that's what artists have to contribute to society, because most of the time we compartmentalize our experiences in tidy ways so that, you know, we're not bothered by this while we're thinking about that. But in my poetry, at least, I don't. I just bring things together that don't usually belong together or are not thought to belong together, and I see what happens, you know, what kind of friction is created.
People might think that that type of subject, financial news, is not necessarily the thing of poets and poetry, but how did you bring those together, and at what time were you writing these things?
I was writing it in 2008 and 2009, so some of the poems, the poem that I read called Bubble Wrap, really almost all of the material in that poem was taken down on the day that the stock market lost about half of its value. So that day, it seemed like it might all vanish, you know. There's a line in the poem about the black hole at the heart of it is taking it all back. And obviously that was scary, but I was sort of ambivalent about it in a way. I mean, that it seems like if value can suddenly disappear that way, then what kind of value was it? It's a sort of magic value, you know, that they can create out of nothing and then it can disappear. So I was listening to the language that they use to talk about the crisis. I mean, terms like credit default swap and leveraged buyout. And although the whole thing was horrifying, as a poet and as someone who's interested in language, I couldn't help but be fascinated by those terms and by realizing, really for the first time, that debt wasn't just some kind of necessary evil, but it was now a new sophisticated product that could be packaged and that could be swapped back and forth overnight between banks at a profit. I mean, that was all very strange. And I don't mean to suggest that it was only intellectually stimulating or aesthetically stimulating. I did know people who lost their houses because of this, and I found it extremely infuriating. But I could not write a book all about that. I never write a book or a poem even, not even a single poem that's all about something. What my work does is really to bring different aspects of experience together. So to set what I was hearing and learning about the financial crisis against whatever else I was doing that day, you know, against going to the beach, against a domestic scene. How does what we call, or what we like to think of as normal life, how is that affected by learning this kind of information. So I think what my poetry does is just not separate things. I mean, in a way, that's what poetry has always been good at. Metaphor means, you know, to carry across.
You also were diagnosed with a rare and often very fatal cancer. Can you tell us a bit about that experience?
Yes, it was a kind of cancer I've never heard of, adrenal cortical cancer, which is vanishingly rare, and which kills almost everyone. And I was feeling fine when I was diagnosed. I was getting a little bit of a mustache, and I was irritated by that, so I went to the doctor and said, you know, what's with this? And she said, well, let's give you a blood test. And when the results came back, my blood was just basically full of steroids, because since this was an adrenal tumor, and it had, you know, my, it was like my adrenal gland had gone insane, and it was pumping out steroids. And so no wonder I was feeling fine, but she knew that it was, you know, a tumor. She didn't know at that point whether it was going to be benign or cancerous, so I had a CAT scan. And that very evening, she called me and told me to go to the hospital immediately and have surgery. And so I went to the hospital, stayed there for several hours. They decided I didn't have to have surgery that very night, but I had surgery about 6 days later. They got the whole tumor out, and they didn't see any metastasis, but the sense was that there would be one, because that statistically, that's what usually happens. And so I came home with the sense that although I was still feeling pretty well, I would be getting sick again pretty soon and dying within a few months or a year or 2 years, and then so that I was living on borrowed time. I'd already written about half of the book versed, so I wrote the second half of versed in that frame of mind, under that kind of pressure, and I'm not really sure how I did it, except that I think that writing helps keep me in the present. And so as long as I'm writing, even if I'm writing about death, which I did, I am concentrated in the moment. And so therefore, I am not actually, you know, that afraid. So I think it helped in that way.
Well, this is a very private and personal experience, yes. Almost the most that you can imagine. And yet you still not only balanced it in some of the poems with public language, mm-hmm. or things that were happening, but also shared it with the public. Mm-hmm. And in this sense, it was well received. I mean, winning a number of prizes, including the Pulitzer. Yeah. How have you responded to that? Something so very private and personal being so public and so well received?
Well, it makes me a little bit nervous or a little bit uncomfortable to think that being ill and surviving illness brought more attention to the book and perhaps got attention for my writing that my writing might not have gotten otherwise. And that seems like cheating in a way or something, you know. And of course it makes me hope that it wasn't just that made the judges select my work. But I'm aware that that's certainly a factor. It gives it a kind of gravitas in people's eyes. And I think that in terms of whether I was going to share it or not, I knew I was going to write about it because I have to write about whatever I'm feeling and thinking. I really, that's the way I live. It's always been the way I live. And I get very depressed, really, if I don't write. And so I knew I had to write about it. And if you're going to write about it, then you can't keep it secret. I mean, yes, it's uncomfortable because the people around you think you're dying, and so they treat you differently. Some of them are kinder, some of them want to stay away. All of that's understandable. There might be a way in which you would want to keep it private. And I respect people who keep their illness private. But I knew that for me, I wasn't going to be able to do that because I was going to write about it, and then I was going to publish what I wrote, and I was going to read from it. And so there just wasn't a chance. I had to go public.
How much personal narrative are in your poems? In one poem in verse, you describe searching out for the place to drop your ashes.
That part actually was based on a dream about looking for a place to have my ashes spread. But there's nothing more personal in a way than dreams, and I do sometimes include dreams in my poems. And, you know, to tell your dreams is almost bad taste. That's really exposing yourself. And I wrote a poem called Own, which is also in verse, that I started while I was still in the hospital. And that includes some dreams I had in the hospital and some sort of hallucinatory experiences too. So I don't censor out personal narrative. Some people think that language poetry is impersonal, but not in my case. I don't censor out anything. I think, you know, some people keep entirely to personal narrative. I don't do that, you know. I let things commingle. And if it's personal as sex or a dream, that can come in. If it's information about credit default swaps, that can come in. And those things can rub elbows. I mean, you know, that's what I'm interested in.
Well, Rae Armantrout, thank you so much for inviting us into your home. It's been a real pleasure to talk with you.
Well, thank you for coming. This was fun.